To our talk on Parenting with Purpose with Ustada Farhat Naik. Today is our sixth session on Empower Your Motherhood. We will begin today by listening to verses from the Holy Quran in Surah Luqman. After that, I hand over to Ustada.
وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِابْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِظُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حملته أمه وهنا على وهن وفصاله في عامين أن اشكر لي ولوالديك إلي المصير وإن جاهداك على أن تشرك بي ما ليس لك به علم فلا تطعهما وصاحبهما في الدنيا معروفا واتبع سبيل من أناب إلي ثم إلي مرجعكم فأنبئكم بما كنتم تعملون يا بني إنها إن تك مثقال حبة من خردل فتكن في صخرة أو في السماوات أو في الأرض يأتي بها الله إن الله لطيف خبير يا بني أقم الصلاة وأمر بالمعروف وانه عن المنكر واصبر على ما أصابك يا بني أقم الصلاة وأمر بالمعروف وانه عن المنكر واصبر على ما أصابك إن ذلك من عزم الأمور ولا تصعر خدك للناس ولا تمش في الأرض مرحا إن الله لا يحب كل مختال فخور وقصد في مشيك واغضض من صوتك وقصد في مشيك واغضض من صوتك إن أنكر الأصوات لصوت الحمير يا بني أقم الصلاة الله أكبر يا بني إنها إن تك مثقال مثقال حبة من خردل فتكن في صخرة أو في السماوات أو في الأرض يأتي بها الله إن الله لطيف خبير يا بني أقم الصلاة وأمر بالمعروف وانه عن المنكر واصبر على ما أصابك إن ذلك من عزم الأمور
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي My beloved sisters in deen, I welcome you with the greetings of peace and mercy. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May the peace, mercy and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on you. A very, very warm welcome to all of you sisters across the globe. Before we start and dwell straight into the topic, let me just quickly revise before you once go through the verses of the glorious Quran which were just recited from Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verses 12 to 19. I'd request sisters to have your Quran copies with you and to go through it so that inshallah we can imbibe it better, inshallah. So Allah says in verse number 12, We gave wisdom to Luqman saying, Give thanks to Allah and the one who pays thanks does so for his own good. And the one who denies his favors should know that Allah is certainly free of all wants, worthy of all praise. When Luqman, while advising his son, said to him, O my son, do not ever commit shirk. That is associating someone else with Allah. Surely committing shirk is the worst iniquity. We have enjoined man concerning his parents. His mother carries him in his womb while suffering weakness upon weakness and then weans him in 2 years. That's why we commanded him, give thanks to me and to your parents. And to your parents, and keep in mind that to me is your final goal. If they argue with you to commit shirk, of which you have no knowledge, then do not obey them. However, you should still treat them kindly in this world. But follow not the way of that individual who has turned to me. After all, to me is your return. Then I will inform you about the reality of all that you have done. Luqman further said, O my son, Allah will bring all things to light, be they as small as a grain of a mustard seed, be they hidden inside a rock, or high above in the heavens, or deep down in the earth. Allah knows the finest mysteries and is all aware of all the things. O my son, establish salah, enjoin good and forbid evil. Endure with patience whatever befalls you. Surely by all is of the matters requiring determination. Do not speak to the people with your face turned away with pride, nor walk proudly on the earth. For Allah does not love any self-conceited boaster. Be moderate in your pace and lower your voice, for the harshest of the voice is the braying of a donkey. Sadaqallahul Azim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Al-malu wal-banuna zinatul hayatid dunya. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Innama amwalukum wa auladukum fitna. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. So beloved sisters, inshallah the topic for this session is, we are continuing with the session of Empower Your Motherhood. It's the part 6 today, and the topic we are going to deal with is parenting with purpose. So inshallah we will see this in the light of Luqman's advice to his son. Now before we go ahead with the topic, let us first understand a few definitions. Parenting with purpose. Firstly, the definition of parenting. What is parenting? According to the dictionary, parenting is defined as the raising of children and all the responsibilities and activities that are involved in it. So that is parenting. Now, what is the definition of purpose? Purpose is the goal. Purpose could be the aim of doing something. Purpose is something that gives life to the act. A purpose is also defined by various people, you know, in various ways, and they have said that purpose is something that pulls you towards itself, gives you, you know, the passion and perseverance to perform that act. Purpose is something which is also associated with a huge magnet. It's like, you know, if you have purpose in your life, it's like a huge magnet which keeps you drawing towards itself. How the magnet pulls, that's how purpose brings passion. It's like, you know, it's like being injected with a massive injection of enthusiasm. Something that you do with a purpose and without a purpose, something which is with a purpose is full of enthusiasm, and enthusiasm is energy. So purpose is something that gives life to that act. Now we come to the part of what is parenting in Islam and what is the purpose of life in Islam. So in order to understand the purpose of life, we go to the word of Allah. And Allah mentions in the glorious Quran in chapter number 51, verse number 56, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. We have created mankind and jinn only for ibadah. Ibadah comes from the root word abd, which means submission to the will of Allah, which comes from the root word abd. And what is abd? Abd is a slave. Abd is a servant of the master, a slave of Allah. So ubudiyah is complete and unconditional submission to Allah. So when a slave submits to Allah, Allah is pleased. And that act, whatever the person does, if that act is pleasing to Allah, it is counted as ibadah. Right? So ibadah is worship of Allah. Any act that pleases Allah, any act that is done to please Allah becomes ibadah. Whether we are doing our salah, whether we are reading the Quran, whether we are going out and educating ourselves, or whether we are going and earning a living, if it is done in a way that Allah is pleased with, inshallah, inshallah, it will be counted as ibadah and we will be rewarded for it. Subhanallah. So that is the purpose of our lives. Now, if our purpose, that is, if the parents' purpose is in congruence with the purpose of life of the child, that would be parenting with purpose. So if the parents have a purpose, they will carry on and give that purpose to the child. That becomes parenting with purpose. Parenting with purpose is having certain goals in mind, having a purpose in mind, and parenting the child. That means raising children with a goal in mind, raising children with a proper purpose in mind. For example, if I was to ask, what is the purpose of raising your child? Many of the mothers perhaps would just not know, or maybe they have not thought about it. So parenting with purpose means having a purpose. Why am I raising the children? What is the purpose behind my child? What do I expect my child to do? How do I expect my child to live his or her own life? And after I am not there in this world, what are my expectations from the child? What are the expectations that Allah wants me to have? What is the destination of my child? What is the legacy that my child is going to leave behind? What is the mission of bringing, what is the mission of raising these children that I am raising? And why am I raising them in a particular way? So all this comes under parenting with purpose. Now, sisters, you know, as far as the topic of parenting itself is concerned, it could be divided into three parts. Okay? The first is how, in fact, the question of how do people parent the child? How is parenting done? So there are three ways in which it could be done. One is aimless parenting. The other is, okay, people have a purpose of parenting, but it could be the wrong purpose. And the third is parenting with the right purpose. That is what we are going to deal with today. And inshallah, we will see what are the fundamental principles of parenting with purpose and what are the benefits that we get when we parent with purpose. But before that, what happens in aimless parenting? Aimless parenting is not thinking, just, you know, a child is born, the child is raised, aimlessly living, eating, drinking, being merry, enjoying life. Life is just a coincidence. Just because somebody is born, somebody lives and dies. That's it. No aim, nothing to achieve, nothing to gain. No purpose in mind at all. Then the next is parenting with the wrong purpose. Okay, some people have a purpose in mind, but what is the purpose? The purpose may be, okay, just to raise children so that, you know, they earn a good living or they are successful in life, or maybe some may say so that they are happy in life, or maybe, you know, to lead a luxurious life, or maybe to have a villa or to become a big businessman or something of that kind maybe. So we need to ask ourselves today, what is the purpose of parenting my child? What is my purpose of parenting children? We need to ask ourselves this, right? Parenting with purpose. Now coming to parenting with purpose. When the ultimate objective of a parent is to please Allah. Her entire process, I mean both the mother and the father, his entire process of striving to be effective, to be impactful, her passion, her burning desire to create a generation pleasing to Allah, to create think tanks, leaders, and role models that leave an impact in society. That is parenting with purpose. A parent with purpose is an awakened parent. A parent with purpose is aware and tells the child, or whatever the parent speaks to the child today, knows that it will have an impact 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 40 years, 70 years. The words will have an impact in the grave and also in the hereafter. And I repeat this important statement, my dear sisters. Parenting with purpose is that a parent knows, a mother and a father know, that what I tell my child today, what I speak to my child today, even if it's one sentence, if what I speak to my child today will have an impact on the child's mind, on the child's personality today, in the next 2 years, in the next 10 years, 20 years, 70 years, 90 years, in the grave, on the day of judgment, and in the hereafter. So that is parenting with purpose. When you have in mind the fact that I am responsible for everything that I do, when a parent has in mind that and therefore speaks very consciously to the children, that is parenting with purpose. And in contrast, if we see aimless parenting, if one was to ask you, what are the features of the present society? Undoubtedly, we would say that we are at the zenith. We are at the crescent of progress. And we've reached the heights of science and technology in all spheres of human activity. But we agree that we are also at the heights of moral degradation. Violence, murder, terror, hatred, adultery, fornication, rape, obscenity, vulgarity, gambling, corruption, racism, consumerism, homosexuality, lesbians, transgenders, gays, drugs, alcohol abuse. In fact, the increase in the youth crimes has made them so vulnerable that our future generations and our future leaders easily fall prey to these evils. This has led to an increase in individualism and family breakdown. And we are losing our youth. We are losing our families. If we are to analyze what is the reason of this extreme moral decay, why has this extreme moral decay happened? Two major reasons, my dear sisters. One is improper or aimless parenting. And second is because we only cater to intellectual education and there is no value-based education. Unfortunately, there is no training of the heart. So what happens is intellectual education influences the head, that is the mind, and value-based education influences the heart. In fact, if education does not train the heart, it can be dangerous. In fact, Aristotle said, educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all. So a minimum level of moral and ethical literacy is a must. A morally educated person will be a lot better equipped to succeed in life than a morally bankrupt person, even if he has excellent academic qualifications. those excellent academic qualifications will be of no use. And let me quote to you, my dear sisters, Professor Mueller of Johns Hopkins University states, you know, universities today are producing highly skilled barbarians because we fail to provide a framework of moral values. It's like mind without morals. And mind without morals creates maniacs in society. In fact, true education is both the of the mind and the heart. And that is exactly what Islam aims at. And that's exactly what we want to do when we are speaking of parenting with purpose. You see, sisters, the Westerners are advanced in science and technology, but sorry to say, extremely degraded in morals. When we speak of parenting with purpose, we want to have both an education system, an Islamic education, where we are striving to attain success. But then again, when we speak of parenting with purpose, it is keeping in mind being super advanced in science and technology. Along with that, we need to have the Quran and Sunnah in one hand and the latest branches of science and technology in the other hand. This integration of the two with a proper goal in mind is about parenting with purpose. That is something which we need to take care of. Again, if we reflect upon purposeless or aimless parenting, at its very best may give you an outcome, a product of mere success in this world. Sometimes it may so happen, okay, you have a purpose, you want to make your children doctors and engineers. Okay, fine, it may happen so. But if there's no purpose behind parenting and if the purpose is a very flimsy purpose, then what happens? At the most, you know, it may give you superficially successful doctors and engineers, architects and PhDs, but aimless parenting may give you a good career and financially secure job, but strangely, we see highly educated individuals with great degrees and PhDs in biochemistry, nuclear physics, doctors of genetic engineering, and you name, you know, the micro levels that we have reached to of specialization. But unfortunately, the same person cannot be a good father. The same specialist cannot be a good husband, cannot be a good mother, cannot be a good son. Strangely and sadly, you know, the nuclear physicist or the gynecologist who cannot be a good father, cannot be a good mother. It's so strange. We have extremely knowledgeable people, but they don't even know how to talk with their own family. It's so ironic. And why does this happen? This is because of lack of a value system. This is because of lack of morals. We are deprived of a moral system, which is the need of the hour. When we speak of parenting with purpose, you know, there are certain fundamentals because we see the dire consequences, what happens, you see? And that is the reason it drives us back home to understand that that our very deen, Islam, provides the best framework such that it leads to success in this world as well as the hereafter. So if you want to understand the fundamentals of parenting with purpose, you know, there are 11 fundamentals which we can study in the light of the advice that was given to Luqman's son by Luqman the wise. And that is mentioned in the glorious Quran from verse number 12 to verse number 19. Okay, So one by one, inshallah, we will see that. But before we go ahead with all the 11 fundamental principles, my dear sisters, let me tell you, let me just establish the fact and let me tell you why did we select these verses and why did we select this advice that was given by Luqman to his son. Here, you know, sisters, a few important reflections which we must keep in mind before we go ahead, and that is, Allah sometimes chooses not to mention the name of the people in the glorious Quran, although they are such important personalities. Like, let me give you an example, that is in Suratul Yasin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in chapter 36, verse number 13 and 14, Allah mentions, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَسَلًا أَصْحَابَ الْقَرْيَةِ إِجَاءَهَا الْمُرْسَلُونَ إِذْ أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِمُ اثْنَيْنِ فَكَذَّبُوهُمَا فَأَزَّزْنَا بِثَالِثٍ فَقَالُوا إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ مُرْسَلُونَ. Your and this entire, in the next couple of verses, the story goes on, and it is about two messengers that Allah is speaking of. In fact, three messengers that the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking of, about the messengers, without mentioning the name of the messengers. We don't know who these messengers were. The story is mentioned here, right? That's one point. Secondly, we also know in Surah Kahf, Allah mentions in Surah Kahf, we know, which we recite on Friday, chapter number 18, verses 60 to verse number 82, is the story of what? Story of Musa alayhi salam and Khizr alayhi salam, right? But we know here that when Allah mentions in verse number 65, فَوَجَدَ عَبْدًا مِّنْ عِبَادِنَا آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِّنْ إِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. That is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just speaking of Khizr alayhi salam so much in detail, yet his name is not mentioned. Okay? So understand the fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses people in the glorious Quran, but he chooses not to name some people, right? Now let me give you another third example. The third example is that of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an. And we know in Surah At-Tawbah, that is chapter number 9, verse number 40, that entire episode again is mentioned when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, and when he said, Illa tansuruhu faqad nasarullah, is akhrajahu lazina kafaru thaniyas naini is huma fi gharin is yakulu li sahibihi la tahzan inna allaha ma'ana. That is, have no fear, for Allah is with us. That is what was told Abu Bakr Siddiq, but the name is not mentioned. So we have established three places in the glorious Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not mentioned the name. One is in the Surah Yasin, where Allah did not mention the name of three messengers. Then the next is in Surah Kahf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention the name of Khizr alayhi salam. Then the third is in Surah At-Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not mentioned the name of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. But Allah gave special honor to Luqman the wise by naming him here in Surah Luqman. In fact, it's not the name only which is mentioned here, but an entire surah is dedicated to his personality. He is not a prophet, He's not very popular for anything else but for his hikmah, right? He is popular for his wisdom, my dear sisters. Allah says, we bestowed wisdom on Luqman. Show gratitude to Allah. And who is so grateful does so to the profit of his own soul. But if you are ungrateful, verily Allah is free of all wants, worthy of all praise. So we establish this fact first before dwelling into it, that why are these verses so important? Why am I highlighting these verses? To emphasize the fact that the teachings that are coming are very, very heavy. We cannot take them lightly. Allah has mentioned especially the description and the dialogue that Luqman the wise gave to his son. Now see, my dear sisters, another important reflection is the Quran speaks of various dialogues of father and son, right? What are the conversations of father and son, or which father and son example Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given in the glorious Quran? Can you give me some? Allah speaks of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the father, that description has been given. Yusuf alayhi salam, yes, with Yaqub alayhi salam. Nuh alayhi salam and the son. And even after that, even in the history of Islam, there are so many father-son conversations. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this particular conversation, and Allah loved it so much that Allah placed it in the glorious Quran. The conversation between, a private conversation between the father and son has been placed here, right? And Allah decided to place it in the glorious Quran. Until the day of judgment, it's going to be there, subhanallah. And people will read and learn from the example. There is something very heavy coming. That is the reason Allah chose this. This is something so fundamental, something so important, something which strengthens our roots. And that is the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has probably chosen this. So we understand this and we establish the fact before we dwell into it. Allah makes Luqman the wise a hero. He makes him a champion. He makes him the superstar. Why? Only because of the wisdom that he had. Wisdom is so very important, my dear sisters, and especially in raising children, especially in parenting children, wisdom is so important. So Allah makes a celebrity out of someone totally unknown, right? Allah makes Luqman the wise a celebrity because of his wisdom, saying that we gave Luqman the wisdom. Who gave this wisdom to Luqman? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself gives it. And what is the wisdom? Wisdom actually means beneficial, to have beneficial knowledge and to act upon it. Right? So having beneficial knowledge and acting upon it, to know the deep truth and to live by it. That is wisdom. And then after that, what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying here? Be grateful to Allah, for whoever is grateful, it is only for their own souls. So, and the whole summary about wisdom has been placed firstly as being anishkur lillah. Right? So the first thing that has been told to him is by his father is be grateful to Allah. Now we go ahead with what are the teachings of Luqman to his son. And the very first thing, the very first fundamental is what, sisters? Which is in verse number 13. Strict and uncompromising tawheed. Behold, Luqman said to his son by way of instruction. Now, is ala Luqmanu li ibnihi wa huwa? So here, what is being established, my dear sisters, that he is teaching the son in a very loving way. Ya bunayya, oh my little son, oh my loving son. It's a style of and the language of love, which has been expressed by Luqman. And he's telling the very first thing that he is speaking to him is about strict and uncompromising monotheism. Right? Now, as far as teaching Tawheed is concerned to our children, unfortunately, you know, sisters, many times it happens that, you know, we try our best to teach Tawheed to our children, but there's a lot of confusion that takes place. How? Although we keep telling that, okay, Allah is the only you have to bow down to. Allah is the one we have to, you know, Allah is the one who rules the family. Allah is the one who decides. Allah's word decides. What are we going to do? How are we going to live the life? But we ourselves confuse our kids many times, isn't it? We remember Islam when it's at a threat. Now remember when it's slipping away from our hands, Islam, which is actually supposed to be the standard benchmark. But in reality, do we treat it so? Like how Luqman taught his son, when he's teaching Tawheed, absolute clarity. There's no confusion, right? Do not associate partners with Allah. But I will put my child in a school where there is partying, where there's music, where there's intermingling of sexes, every day where there is dancing and music. So the child is going to be absolutely confused, right or wrong. It's like, you know, saying, sisters, you switch on the AC, but you keep the doors and the windows open. So what's happening? We are teaching Tawheed. We are saying, don't bow down to anybody else. There's no compromise. We are teaching that, but our practice is something else. So it's like you switch on the AC, but you will not get the benefit from it because you keep the doors and the windows open. A'udzubillah. See, we do not teach shirk to our children. Obviously, we teach them Tawheed. But here, what is being said about Tawheed and what is being said about shirk? La tushrik billah. Inna shirka la zulmun azim. For false worship is indeed the highest wrongdoing. Zulmun azim is what? The highest type of wrongdoing. In another place in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of shirk in a similar manner in chapter 4, verse number 116. And Allah says, وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ دَلَّ دَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. What is that? And one who joins other gods with Allah has strayed far, far away from the right path. What is dalla dalalam baida? That is something that the person has gone far, far away, straight too far away. Imagine, you know, to go somewhere so far that it's so difficult to come back. That kind of, you know, a feeling it is when a person does something which is like associating partners to Allah. What we have to do is we follow Tawheed and explain the concept of Tawheed to the children. Now, what is one of the best ways to tell the little children about Tawheed is sujood is not possible to anyone. Now, what is sujood? What do you mean by sujood? Sujood is also submission, right? When you're lowering your highest part of the body to the lowest part down, it means you're humbling yourself, humbling of the mind and humbling of the body. Can one do sujood and listen to somebody else? Sujood only to Allah, but listen to the friends. Will that sujood be a meaningful sujood? No. So the thing is, it's not just the sujood that we do to Allah, but it is complete and unconditional obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to His commandments, whatever Allah says. Complete reliance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be taught. You know, that has to be done via the connection with Allah. If, my dear sisters, if Tawheed is taught at the right age, in the right manner, via tarbiyah, inshallah, all the other next steps will be easy to be taught. But if Tawheed is weak, but if the roots and the foundation is not strong, then obviously, you know, one storm or one huge wind, one strong wind will come and it will shake the tree. If we want to have proper fruits, we have to make sure that the tree has strong foundations. Therefore, Tawheed has to be very, very strong in the child right from the beginning. And that can be done with tarbiyah, with a lot of love and affection, with a lot of stories, by telling that how much Allah has blessed us with, how much Allah has given us. All that can be told. Right? Then we go to the second important principle. وَوَسَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَحْنًا عَلَى وَحْنًا. That we have enjoined on man to be good to his parents. In travail upon travail did his mother bear him, and in years twain was his weaning. So here the command, show gratitude to me and to your parents. To me is the final goal. Then Allah is saying that, right? So this is about respect to parents. We all want that the children should respect us, isn't it? We all parents want that children should love, children should respect them, children should, you know, obey them. But the key to this is to make the child the abd of Allah. The key to this is to teach lessons of Tawheed very strongly. If the child obeys Allah, if the child respects the commandment of Allah, inshallah, respect to parents comes automatically. If step one is not done properly, then the other steps will be difficult. If you teach Tawheed, the second will follow automatically, inshallah. Because what happens is that it is Allah's commandment. Automatically, the child will want to follow and obey Allah. But if it is the other way around, that is, if we do step two first, or when step two is at stake, when we see that the child is not respecting the parent, and that time when we see Islam slipping away from our hands, and then we take the child when the child is 17, 18 year old, and we run to the sheikhs, you know, and say that, you know, please talk to my child, he does not respect the father. Then what happens? It's very difficult at that point of time to do that. Becoming a haram police or telling the child directly, how can you do this? Quran says, you know, and you bring Quran in between and you say that Allah will punish you because you're disrespecting the parent. That's not fair. We are actually using Islam if we are doing that. Much before that, when the child is smaller, we got to teach the child to obey Allah If we do that one thing, other things will follow. We don't even need to tell the child to respect parents. We don't even need to tell the child to respect us. The key is building tawheed, my dear sisters. The key is to develop. The key to build strong individuals is to build tawheed. If we build the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, inshallah, things will fall in place. You know, there's this example a sister was sharing the other day. And she was like, you know, this youth was behaving rudely with the father. You know, youth, especially when they attain the age of adolescence, maybe, you know, 14, 15, 16 year old boys, once was confronting the father. Father asked him to do something. He refused to do. And he raised his voice in front of the father. And so that time, the mother did not tell him anything. But later on, after that, the mother called him and told him in a nice way that it's not right the way you spoke to the father. And the response of the son was, you don't know how Baba does, and you know how he do, how he's getting upset, or he's shouting at me, or whatever, you know. The boy started complaining. The mother said, yeah, I understand. At times, Baba can be a little, you know, strict, or Baba can be a little rude, or maybe I can be a little rude. But what does the Quran say? And this child was raised in Islamic, was raised in an Islamic environment. So what does the Quran say? Please open the Quran, my dear son, and read. And she made him read the glorious Quran and the verses which speak of respecting parents. And this mother says that after that, never ever did this young boy raise his voice to the father nor the mother, because the groundwork was already done. It was just a gentle reminder that was required. But what happens if the groundwork is not done, if the foundation is not laid? So alhamdulillah, the child, this boy, the youth did not repeat that after that. And let me quote here to you an educationist who's a non-Muslim, Billy Graham. He said, and I quote his words, he says, if a child is allowed to be disrespectful to his parents, he will not have true respect for anyone. Right? So how do we teach children to respect parents? The best teacher is the glorious Quran. And we teach them tawheed. We let the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala flow in the bloodstream of the child. And if that happens, my dear sisters, we don't need to be a haram police all the time. We then don't need to keep reminding children of, you know, how they need to respect us, inshallah. Then Allah speaks in the next verse, in that is chapter number 31, verses 14. Also in verse number 12, that is the point of gratitude which Allah has mentioned. Again here in point number 14, and we have enjoined a man to be good to his parents. In travail upon travail did his mother bear him, and in years twain was his weaning. Show gratitude to me and to your parents, and to me is your final goal. So here, what is mentioned is anishkurli wali walidayya ilayyal masir. And to me is your final goal. Final return is to me. That means you're going to come to me for accountability finally. And before that, what is being established here is Luqman the wise is telling, who has been bestowed with wisdom. And in a nutshell, the summary of the wisdom is what? Show gratitude to Allah. That is in verse number 12. Anishkur lillah. Right? That is show gratitude to Allah. So showing gratitude to Allah, gratitude to our parents, our children have to show gratitude to us. Gratitude to Allah and gratitude to the Abd of Allah. Now, this is something which is of utmost importance. Imagine after worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, respecting parents, this is something which is required to, you know, to be taught to the children, because this is going to go a long way in building strong individuals, in building stronger families, in building great homes, inshallah. You know, sisters, as far as gratitude is concerned, many a times I've given the example of of two girls, you know, having cake. One girl has the full cake. One girl has the full cake, except only 1/10 is missing. And the other girl has only 1/10 piece of the cake. Right? Who has to be more grateful? Who has to show more gratitude? Girl one or girl two? Girl one has the full cake, but 1/10 is missing. Only 1/10 is missing, and the girl is very sad. And the other girl two has got only 1/10 of the cake, but is bubbling with joy and is so happy. Technically speaking, who has to be more happy? Logically speaking, who has to be happier? Yes, sisters? Who has to be happier? Exactly. The one who has the entire cake but one, right? She has to be happier. But the difference is, my dear sisters, the focus is wrong of girl number one. She's focusing on what is missing, right? And girl two is focusing on what she has. When your focus is wrong, you are drowned in negativity. Although she has more cake, yet she's sad because she feels that it's not the whole cake and something is missing. Girl two has just a little cake, but she is happier because she focuses on what she has. Subhanallah. This example can go along. You see, drowning ourselves in negativity can actually be paralyzing. You know, many a times we see when you get up in the morning, it's all about complaints. Complaining about the house, complaining about not having time for breakfast, complaining about the job, complaining about kids, complaining all the time. This can be very, very detrimental. It's actually hurting yourself. In contrast, if gratitude is the attitude, it will run in the family. If the parents are grateful in the morning, and if that is what is expressed and seen and displayed, it's going to leave an ambience of gratitude around. It's going to leave a legacy of gratitude around. Even if there is little, but if there is gratitude, inshallah, it will be liberating. Life of gratitude is actually liberating. It frees you from negativity, makes you capable to do much more optimistic things in life, and optimism invites more from Allah. Allah says, right, if you are grateful, I shall give you more. What do you mean, I shall give you more? More what? What do we want more? More of guidance, more of health, more of provision, more of risk. And risk, my dear sisters, is not just money and wealth. It's not just the treasure. Having a good neighbor, having a good servant, having good friends, having Islamic company, having good teachers. being able to do little in so much time, being able to, you know, do your best throughout the day, all that is rizq. So Allah will increase. If we are grateful, Allah will give us more. Imagine if there are two children in, you have, and you gift both of them. And if one child thanks you for the gift and comes around and kisses you and hugs you and says, Mama, I love you so much. Thank you so much for this. And again, if the child comes back to you and says, this is such a useful gift that you gave me, Mama. And the other girl or the other child of yours does not even bother to thank you, does not be grateful to the for the gift to you, what would you feel? Wouldn't you want to give the one who thanked you even more? Obviously, we as human beings do that, right? Imagine if we thank Allah, Allah will give us so much more. Alhamdulillah, Allah gives us, even if whether we thank or no, all the basics and much more, Allah gives us. Alhamdulillah. But the key to invite more barakah is by teaching gratitude to our children. And believe me, sisters, if you are a part of a group of sisters who only invite negativity or only speak about the material world, you know, imagine if you're going and you're attending a function where everybody just, you know, brags about their clothes and their brands and their family and their homes. And the way they're leading their lives, they just brag about all that. They just show off all that. If you're going to come back home, what is the kind of feelings that you bring back home? A feeling of being deprived, a feeling that I don't have as much as they have. So what's the point in befriending such people who are going to talk only about materialism, only about this world? And in contrast, you go to an Islamic function or you go to an Islamic program where you are charged and you're recharged with the values of gratitude, where you're recharged with thankfulness and the attitude of being grateful to Allah. Or even if you go to the gathering where people meet for the sake of Allah, they remember Allah, your knowledge increases. When you come back home, what is the sense of the feelings that runs into your mind? Are you going to come back home with a positive feeling, happier? You'll be better to the family and the children as compared to going to a materialistic gathering and, you know, just seeing all the comparisons out there and coming back home. It's not going to give you anything. In fact, it's going to lead to more negativity. So if you have friends that are only materialistic, that are not talking about Allah, that are not being grateful to Allah, then it's high time you say assalamu alaikum and leave and completely leave the negative club and be a part of positive gatherings. You know, my dear sisters, let me tell you one small exercise that you all can do, inshallah. And that is something, it will just take 5 minutes of your day every day. And what do we do? How to develop an attitude of gratitude. Every day, 5 times a day, when the muazzin calls the adhan, what do we do? When the adhan is called out, what do? Immediately we repeat the adhan, right? What, for example, if you're doing some work, some physical work, or if you're doing anything mechanical, you repeat the adhan. I'm not counting that time of repetition of the adhan. After the adhan is over, you know what happens? The gates of heavens are open. Whatever dua we ask Allah, Allah accepts that dua. So we just take out 1 minute to recharge ourselves with positivity. Just 1 minute we take out, and what do? We pray to Allah. Whatever dua you want to ask, ask Allah. Along with that, ask Allah to make me grateful. Make me positive, Allah. Recharge me. it's like, you know, being recharged. Every adhan, just 1 minute. So we have 5 adhan in a day. So 5 minutes of investment. The moment the adhan is called out, we repeat the adhan, we wait, we pause for a moment, we just stop there, and immediately, just for 1 minute, I'm not telling you wait for 3 minutes, 4 minutes. It's just 1 minute. Just take out 1 minute and ask Allah immediately. Have your list ready, or your 5 duas, or one dua, whatever one you want. You want to pray for your one child? Okay, just that one dua. Along with that, ask Allah, Allah, make me a grateful servant of yours. Right? Can we all do that, inshallah, my dear sisters? 5 minutes in a day, an investment worth millions of dollars. An investment worth millions of dollars, my dear sisters. Right? And then immediately we recite the dua after the adhan. Anyways, we recite the dua after the adhan. Right? So before we recite the dua after the adhan, or after we recite the dua after the adhan, inshallah, we just make this 1 minute positivity time. And then we proceed for salah. If we are in a state of wudu, alhamdulillah, immediately we stand up for salah. Right? Because Allah loves the act. Our dua is accepted. Our salah is accepted. Inshallah, inshallah, the whole ambience in the family will be that of positivity, inshallah. Okay? So, but my dear sisters, remember, if our children see us complaining all the time, negative approach, no appreciation, not even appreciating the children, not appreciating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not appreciating our spouses. If they see a negative look on our face, the bichara look, you know, that as if we are very tired all the time, there's so much work to do, there's so much, you know, there's so much stress in the house, that sad look, that upset look, then what's going to happen? That is what the children are going to feel. You know, if we are positively charged, there are going to be positive vibes in the family, inshallah. And people of hikmah, Luqman the wise, what did Allah Ta'ala tell him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advised him to be thankful to him. Anishkur lillah. Right? So we have to remember that formula. People of hikmah, people of shukr, how can a believer be miserable? How can a believer be sad all the time? Okay, we understand. Once in a while, sometimes we may be sad, but not always upset, but not always that sad look on our face. We keep reminding ourselves again and again that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is grateful and He will give us the best, and we think of the best from Allah. Inshallah, inshallah, He will give us the best also. So gratitude is the attitude, and I want to take some more time as far as gratitude is concerned, sisters. See, gratitude is not just an act. It is an attitude. How? Not just what we do, but also how we do it. For example, you can eat the same plate of food like your friend is eating, but the way you're eating it can make a whole world of a difference. You know, two people eating the same plate of food, one person can be full of gratitude. The person can be with every morsel. You know, when you begin your food, you say Bismillah in the name of Allah, and you think of so many others who are deprived of food. This meal that I'm eating, so many others are deprived of it. And the other person just gulps down without thinking anything, not remembering to say Bismillah, just enjoying the meal, just enjoying the food, not bothered to thank anyone, not appreciating the one who cooked it, not appreciating anything about the food, from where it came. No, just eating it, just enjoying, or maybe even complaining at times. Allahu Akbar. And there's another person who appreciates every morsel, thanks Allah, you know, chews properly, enjoys the meal. Otherwise, one thing everyone searches when you sit and eat the meal. Tell me, what is it that people generally search in the house when they start the meal? Any clues? But Islamic homes don't do that. At least where the fear of Allah is there. At least where thankful homes don't do that. Yes, they say Bismillah, I know. But I'm saying, what do they search for? Usually homes and families, they search for the remote. Remote for what? A'udhu billah. Yeah, or mobile. Remote so that they can watch the serials, so that whatever is seen, all the emotions are getting inside your body and your mind and your heart. A'udhu billah. You know, when you're eating, you need to be so positive. You need to be happy. You need to be grateful and thankful to Allah so that inshallah, whatever gets inside the body, the system, inshallah, it gives the best results. And imagine if you're seeing a violent scene, or if you're seeing, you don't even realize what you're eating, auzubillah. So two people eating food, but one can be really grateful and get the best out of that 10 to 15 minutes of eating food or 20 minutes of enjoying the meal can be rewarding for you physically, emotionally, spiritually, can get you connected to Allah and can invite much more. That is the blessings, the barakah that Allah will put in there. The angels will say Ameen when you say dua. Alhamdulillah illazi akamani haza wa razaqni min ghairi hawlin minni wala quwwa. When you say that, all your sins will be forgiven, inshallah. As contrast to the one who's carelessly eating it like that. It's the same plate of food. Both are enjoying. The same example can be extended. To take example of, you know, a construction site. And there are three workers working on the construction site. There's an observer there. And this observer, what he does is that he's just very consciously observing all the three workers. They're doing the same activity. What are they doing? They're building a wall. So they're placing the bricks, they're putting the cement, and they're making a nice structure. This elderly gentleman who's observing, he goes to the first worker, first construction worker, and he asks him, he says, what are you doing? The labor, the construction worker, he replies, I'm earning my living. I'm earning my bread and butter. He goes to the second worker. He asks, what are you doing? The second worker says, I'm building a wall. Don't you see I'm placing the bricks and I'm putting cement and I'm building a wall? The same question is asked to the third worker. What are you doing? The third worker says, well, I'm making a beautiful monument. What does he say, the third worker? I am making a beautiful monument. Same people, same activity, same amount of remuneration, same amount of time taken, but the thought, the attitude, the vision of all three is different. Right? The thought, the attitude, the vision, the mission, the dream of all three is different. Same people, same activity, but different visions. Similarly, we can take the example of three mothers. The three mothers, all the mothers feed the children, dress the children, send them to school, bring them back home, pick up and drop, give them food. Same things the mothers do. But why is it different that one mother stands out? Why is it different that some mothers stand out? And why is it different that some mothers have a vision? And that is visionary parenting. And that is parenting with purpose. Right? So, my dear sisters, the examples of three mothers, you know, all three mothers feed the baby, dress them up to school, make them wear the matching socks and matching shoes and exactly very well ironed clothes. All that all three mothers do, right? But why is it that what is different amongst them? It's the attitude, like the three workers. You know, the whole idea is parenting with purpose is having the purpose in mind and then going ahead and doing everything. Unfortunately, you know, what the trend is today is more that of ungratefulness. And sorry to say, my dear sisters, who is it that teaches brand consciousness to the children? Who is it that teaches them to be more ungrateful? Unfortunately, it is we parents who teach them that. Our kids are so entitled today. You know, they feel so entitled today. And that's the major problem. It's so difficult for the children to be grateful. You know, if we compare our lives to the lives of our children, they get everything in a platter today. Probably we struggle more in our lives as compared to what the children do today. Luxury is, you know, it's at their hands today. It's something that we need to take care of. And that is what our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has reminded us that, you know, maybe other things may not be there, but we got to be very careful where materialism is concerned. And somehow materialism does creep in as far as, you know, the youth today and the children today is concerned. It's, you know, today, which university they want to go to, they have the choice. What car brands they want, they have their own choices. They don't see the struggle, and therefore, you know, it's very important to teach them the value of money. It's very important, my dear sisters, to teach them the value of money. You may have destroyed them by getting a nicer house full of toys. Their eyes are on the next toy. And the earlier one goes in the trash. 2 days later, the next one comes. Right? And here Allah is teaching us an anishkur lillah. Teach them the value of rizq. Not keeping their eyes on what they do not have. I mean, you know, it's very, very sad, my dear sisters, that sometimes it's scary to see how the children behave. We are literally turning children into monsters, auzubillah, consumers, more and more, and I want more and more and more and more. There are examples where a 17-year-old son is telling the parents, if you don't give me the latest iPhone, I'm going to kill myself. Auzubillah, you know, no internet. And the youth can feel claustrophobic. They can't breathe if there's no internet. This is the opposite of shukr. Almost like shirk with Allah. It's like worshipping your own self, you know, sisters. Sisters, can you tell me what is the opposite of shukr? What's the opposite of shukr? Exactly. Exactly. That's what I'm coming to. Constantly satisfying your own hawa, your own self is actually what? Is worshipping your own self. So shukr is the opposite. Kufr is the opposite of shukr. Yes, exactly. Not being grateful to Allah. Associating partners with Allah. How do you associate? Who's the partner with Allah? I, me, myself. Nauzubillah. It's like, you know, a youth saying that I, me, myself, I want this and I like this and I'm going to do this. Auzubillah, you're actually worshipping yourself. Kids need guidance, my dear sisters. They don't know. They will become what we make them. Just because we have money, we can't spoil them. Allah save and Allah protect. And we know the dangers of being grateful to Allah. Will they ever be grateful to you? It's interrelated. If they are going to be grateful, ungrateful to Allah, how can they be grateful to you, to us as parents? Then what happens is the moment they become independent, they have nothing to do with us. They will ignore you, dismiss you. They won't respond. And you wonder, I gave and I gave and I gave and I gave so much. And what will be the response? I don't need you anymore. You just fed my greed. Now I can feed it for myself. So I'm independent. The transaction over. The transaction is all over, right? Because I'm independent. I can feed myself now. And we did it out of love. We are shocked. We spoiled them. Yes, we spoiled them by giving them more and more and more. And it's not required, my dear sisters. Parenting with purpose is something where we think and give the child. When we give a toy to the child, we think and give. When we give something to the child, we think what repercussions it's going to have. What are the drastic consequences that are going to take place if we just give and give and give? We're going to spoil the child even more. Sometimes withholding is so much more wiser. And Allah says in chapter 64, verse number 5, Innama amwalukum wa auladukum fitna. Wealth and children are a trial. Allah said so. Money and children are massive trials. Disaster. Sometimes not buying your child the things is good. It's better. Sometimes not giving them is good. Holding back is good. Alhamdulillah has to be lived. It's easier to say Alhamdulillah. But living Alhamdulillah is wisdom. Living Alhamdulillah is gratitude. Otherwise, auzubillah, we are going to turn them into mini Firauns. You know, the mini Karuns and the mini Hamans. Anarabbukumul Ala. You know, it's so scary. Today, I don't want a pizza. I only want a burger. That also only from Burger King. And the poor parents not realizing it is such a blunder to follow whatever the child is saying, and they go, no, that she doesn't eat, you know, poor girl, she doesn't eat, that's why I'm getting for her. Today she doesn't want to eat, so I'm getting. And imagine what happens when this same child grows. The parents run after them with the food in the hand, plate, running after the child. And imagine if the mother has finished everything in the kitchen after 10 o'clock, and the rule is that the child, when you ask for dinner 8 o'clock or maybe 7 o'clock, whatever the principle is in the family, the son says, no, I'm not hungry now, I don't want to eat now. And at 10 o'clock, the child comes and asks you, what are you going to do? What should be the right method? And some mothers think, no problem. It's okay. The child is hungry now. Child is studying. I must give. You reopen the kitchen, make fresh whatever, you know, you want to give the child. And you serve the child. You're actually spoiling the child, isn't it? In contrast, the approach should be, I'm so sorry. Time was over. We called you at 8 o'clock or 7 o'clock to eat whatever the time set is. You set a time. You set the dinner time and everybody sits on the dinner table at the set time. So today, my dear son, you can just have bread and milk maybe, or have some fruits and go to bed. I love you so much, but I'm so sorry. I won't be able to do it now for you. So next time, the child understands that if I want to have dinner, I've got to sit at the right time to eat, or else I've got to go to bed empty stomach. Once this child realizes the lesson, will not come back to you again at the wrong time. That is what is required. Otherwise, we are creating them into, you know, mini Firauns. Whose fault? They are not shayateen. The children are not shayateen. We have to exert control lovingly. We have to put our foot down for principles, but we do it in the most loving manner. Hug the child, kiss the child, you know, do whatever you want to show your love and affection, and genuinely we love our children so much. But we have to exert control on the principles. Like how Luqman said, ya bunayya, oh my son, oh my loving child. It's like, I love you, darling. You know? So it is we who teach them the lessons of extravagance. It is we who teach them to throw food in the first place. So how in the world are they going to respect the food? Having so many lavish dishes, throwing parties. You know, when I have a party in my house, I'm at least going to have 3-4 dishes more than what my neighbor did. A'uzu billah. If that is what the child is going to see, that's what the child is going to learn. We set examples. We set standards. May Allah save us and may Allah protect us from that. So that is as far as the point number 3 is concerned, which was about being grateful. Then we come to point number 4, accountability in the hereafter. In verse number 15, Allah mentions, however, you should still treat them kindly. Okay, that is over. After all, to me is your return, then I will inform you about the reality of all that you do. But if they pressure you to associate with me what you have no knowledge of, do not obey them. Still keep their company in this world courteously and follow the way of those who turn to me in devotion. Then to me will be all of your return, and then I will inform you of what you used to do. So this is the concept of accountability. That is, ourselves we need to develop, that each and everything what I do now is I'm going to be accountable for that, right? I'm going to be accountable for everything that I have done. If we as parents have that in mind, my dear sisters, it's going to run in the child's mind also, inshallah. But if we do not have that, then automatically they will also not have it. Unless and until, like, of course, they have it via some other means. But for the little children, you know, automatically it will come. If we talk, if we show, if we constantly talk about being accountable to Allah in our day-to-day affairs, the kids watch. And they hear us much more than anyone else. The two little eyes that are watching all the time. You know, if we tell them Allah is going to hold me responsible for this act. I have to stand in front of Allah and answer if I'm going to be unjust to you. If I'm going to do anything wrong, I have to stand in front of Allah one day. And that day will be the day of Qiyamah. If we tell that to our children, my dear sisters, you know, automatically they will develop the sense of being accountable to Allah. Not that we speak about the teacher or the police or someone like that. No, we explain to them the concept of accountability in the most loving manner. In my earlier sessions, my dear sisters, I have spoken about the difference between taaleem and tarbiyah. How does tarbiyah take place? That is in detail that I have done. So the tarbiyah, when we are doing the tarbiyah, that is when we have to subtly keep teaching them concept of accountability. That we all are responsible to Allah at the end of the day. He's watching. And that brings us to the next point, which is Allah is all aware. Allah is watching. And that is what has been mentioned in verse number 16. Luqman said, "O my dear son, even if a deed were the weight of a mustard seed, be it hidden in the rock or in the heavens or the earth, Allah will bring it forth. Surely Allah is most aware, most subtle, all aware." Now, this is also a very important point which we need to keep in mind. And we also need to teach this to our children. These are such beautiful teachings, my dear sisters. You know, if we can teach this to our children, there's nothing like, you know, teaching the consciousness of Allah to the children. We have to make them sensitive to Allah, that Allah is always watching you. He is Latifun Khabir. Inna Allaha Latifun Khabir. That is, He is all aware, always watching you. There's not a moment, not a fraction of a second that you can be away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine all the passwords that you have, all the locks that you have, all the secrets that you have are all known to Allah. What is the beautiful example that Allah is giving here? Oh, my dear son, even if a deed were the weight of a mustard seed. Now, can you imagine a mustard seed? And if that is hidden in a rock or in the heavens or in the earth. Now, imagine, you know, Luqman is telling his son, if there is a deed, like if that is equivalent to a mustard seed, which is in the rock, which is in the heavens and the earth. Now, where is the rock? Do you know the rock where it is? No, we don't know. If, for example, even if you find out a rock where it is, where is the rock? In the heavens and the earth. Imagine in the whole of the heavens and the earth, the rock is there. And in that rock, first of all, we will not be able to find out that particular rock. And even if we find the rock and if we break it into two, inside that, we don't know whether it's going to be exactly in the center. Where is the mustard seed? We don't know that. Allah is just showing the greatness, how great He is, how much aware He is, how much He can see. He can even see that speck, the mustard seed. So we can explain to our children and sisters, even a 4, 5 year old will be able to understand this concept, right? So if we have to tell our children to be Allah conscious, that Allah is watching, be sensitive to Allah. If we have to teach them this, literally, like, you know, place the mustard seed in their hands. Give it in their hand, just one mustard seed, and tell them, you know, even if the deed is so small, Allah will know. Even if the deed is so small, you know, you don't need a big deed for Allah to know whether you're hiding, what you're saying to your friend, which social media you're visiting, what message you're texting, what icon, what emoji you're using, what language you're using, what's your expression, what's the kind of facial expressions that you have. Everything Allah knows. We may not know ourselves so well as much as Allah knows us. Right? So just place that mustard seed in the hand of the 5-year-old child and tell him that if this seed was in between the rocks, and the rocks were anywhere in the heavens and the earth, Allah will bring it forth. Why? Because only he has the power. Only he is all aware. So he can do that. Now imagine if we are telling that to our child and explaining the concept of the fact that Allah is watching. So when we make the child aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and when we make the child Allah conscious, inshallah, the child will not do anything wrong even when the child is alone. Why? Because what is running into the system of the child is Allah consciousness. Inshallah, that will not happen. Then we can tell the child, Allah is closer to you than your jugular vein. Quran mentions that. How many of you mothers have told, if you have a 5-year-old child and if you're trying to build the connection to Allah, how many of you have told your children that Allah is closer to you than your own jugular vein? Bring the map, bring the skeleton, show where the jugular vein is in the skeleton, you know, or a picture of a human being. Show where exactly the jugular vein is and explain to the child, see, Allah is closer to us than this jugular vein. So imagine how much Allah can see us. He's watching us. He's aware of us. He's so close to us. He's protecting us. His angels are protecting us. Imagine if we say that. Yeah, so imagine if we say that to the children. How can they not love Allah and fear Allah and think about Allah while doing a wrong thing? Right? So teaching the children the purpose of life, why we are here, we ourselves have to live Islam. If, you know, teaching the children positivity, full of gratitude, always thanking Allah, all that comes, you know, automatically, inshallah. You know, generally when mothers criticize, or generally when mothers come with a list of complaint and they say my child does not do this and my child doesn't do that, and the big list of complaints is there, and one mother also said, you know, that okay, yeah, she was like, okay, my child doesn't do this and that, and you know, so many list of complaints, and then she's saying that, yeah, it's okay, I don't do it, but at least he should do it. Now that's something, you know, not right. It's, I mean, I understand that I don't do it, but at least he should do it. How in the world are we expecting them to do when we don't show by example? Once, you know, it was told by one of the sheikhs to the parents that just sit in one of the corners of your home with a nice cup of coffee and observe the children, what they do. And this father and the mother were observing the children, and they found exactly the same traits, the same language, the same tone in which the parents speak. Exactly the same, right? So whatever we are going to talk, it's the same thing that the children are going to pick up. So That's the reason we need to be very, very careful. After all, hikmah is the correct understanding of ilm and amal. You know, today, my dear sisters, today the children are small and the children are right in front of you. You can control. You can teach the child whatever is best for the child. You can keep a control over a 3, 4, 5, 6, 7-year-old child, maybe up to 10, 11. Today, you can control. Tomorrow, he will move out. Tomorrow is not in control, right? Tomorrow, he will have the exposure of the entire world. So what's in your control? Today, you can impact him while you love him so much. We understand that we as parents love our children so much. But you give that much time to the child at the right time. If the parents give the children their time, what happens is that you're going to impact the child in the best possible way. While in contrast, if you as mother and father, if you love social media, if you're busy on the WhatsApp, if you're busy with serials, if you're busy in the juicy gossip, if you have no time for the kids, it looks and sounds boring to you to take care of the kids. So these are some of the choices that you and I have made. Either ways, we parents have to give them time. Either to build them as good, strong human beings. We give them time either to build and to make them good and strong human beings. Or we give time to repair broken ones. So the choice is ours. And repairing is much more time consuming, much more difficult. It could be damaging. It could be detrimental if not done properly. So the choice is ours. Whereas it's easier to build stronger human beings rather than repairing broken men. Right? Because some mistakes are irreparable, my dear sisters. When kids are small, of impressionable age, missionaries will do whatever you want to them. That's when they need you the most. You know, my dear sisters, when the kids are small, when they are of the impressionable age, they run after you, they beg you, they want you, they miss you, they keep on telling you, Mama, one more story. Mama, please take me out. They are actually at that point of time, they are your missionaries. They will do anything for you, my dear sisters. You tell them and they will run to do what you want them to do. That is the most impressionable age. And that's when we've got to leave impacts. That's when we make them love us the most. Because tarbiya happens when they love you the most. Inshallah, that is when they will want to do anything for you. That's how tarbiya takes place. Right? So that impressionable age, actually what happens, most parents neglect. Why? Because they want to earn a better living, a better home, a villa, a better brand, a better car. And what happens if you break this individual? What happens if instead of making you break the children, you can live your life with a better car, with a better villa, with the better brands, but without the greatest treasure of the world that you have, your own children. Because your choices are clear right from the beginning. Your choices are clear right from the beginning, my dear sisters. We choose. We choose what we want. See, risk is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How much you and I get is decided. Qadar Allah. Allah has written how much you and I are going to get. We only decide how we are going to get it. So you can choose not to take up that extra job, not to work that extra hour, but I'd rather spend it with my children. I'd rather do a little tarbiyah. I'd rather sit a little more time with my child and do a little bit more of the Quran. Right from reciting, right from understanding, right from explanation, all that I'll enjoy that with my child rather than earning that extra dollars. The choice is ours. But we chose, in order to give them a better living, in order to give them a better branded car, in order to give them better lifestyle, we compromise. When we compromise, the results are very clear, right? May Allah save us and may Allah protect us. We don't want that. We don't want. How much is written in my qadar, I am going to get it, irrespective of the fact whether I work extra or I don't. But if I don't do the Islamic tarbiyah, if I do not have the purpose of parenting in my mind, then what will happen is that I will lose on both fronts. In dunya as well as akhirah. I'm going to lose on both the grounds. May Allah save us and may Allah protect us. It's already 7:15. So we just have 15 to 20 minutes. I think I'll continue the next points in the next class next Sunday, inshallah. For today, we will stop here and we'll have a couple of question and answers, inshallah. But let your questions be only pertaining to the first 5 points. We'll deal with the next point, next 5 principles in the next class, inshallah. And then we will go ahead with the benefits. But what we are going to deal with, the benefits of parenting with purpose, is very, very crucial and important, my dear sisters. So please do hang on, keep in touch, and invite others as well. Now I will share the PPT, inshallah. You can share it with all your moms to be, or mothers or grandmoms, inshallah, because it's the question of leaving a legacy. It's the question of having a lifestyle that will benefit us, not just in this world, but also in the hereafter. You know, parenting with purpose is parenting for Jannah. Parenting with purpose is parenting to please Allah. Parenting with purpose is something we do that gives us peace of mind, that gives us tranquility of the heart. Parenting is purpose is parenting that gives us coolness of the eyes. Don't you all want coolness of the eyes, my dear sisters? Don't we want to see the goodness of our children in this life and peacefully sleep in our graves when we die, so that we are happy and content that Allah, I have left a good legacy behind. Allah, I have left practicing children behind who remember you and who pray for me. After all, we want to leave sadqa-e jariya, not azab-e jariya. Children who are going to be disobedient to Allah are going to be a curse for us in the graves. Children who are going to be disobedient to you and to Allah are going to be cursed for us on the day of judgment. Allah mentions in the glorious Quran, my dear sisters, yawma yafirul maru min akhi wa ummihi wa abi wa sahibatihi wa bani, that on that day, man will run away from his own father, from his own brother, from his own children. Why? Because of the fear of that day. Such will be that day. And Quran also says that on the day of judgment, man will himself want to sacrifice his own children in order to run away from what's happening on the day of judgment. Imagine sacrificing our own children, these beloved little children who we love so much. We cannot even bear if a thorn pricks. We feel the pain in our hearts. If our children even burn their little finger, our heart breaks and our heart cries. But imagine on that day, man will be ready to sacrifice this very same loving children. Why? In order to absolve himself, in order to run away from what's happening on the day of judgment. Auzubillah, may Allah save us and may Allah protect us. We pray that Allah makes parenting easy for us. Allah makes parenting a purposeful parenting for us. وَقُولُوا قَوْلِ هَذَا إِنَّهُ وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ إِنَّهُ غَفُرُ الرَّحِيمُ. We have around 15 minutes for Q&A, so maybe we can do that, inshallah. Over to Sister Rohaini.
Jazakallah khairan, Ustada. Sisters, you can type your questions in the chat box. Looks like we've already had some questions. Sister asked how to discipline children without being rude or irrational. Please share some thoughts.
Yeah, that's a very important aspect, you know, as far as parenting is concerned, that you've got to take a lot of precaution as far as, you know, enjoining justice. That's one of the points that is coming later, which we will be doing in detail. Unfortunately, it can happen that there could be moral inconsistencies amongst the parents, and hence, disciplining becomes very difficult sometimes. Also, there could be injustice as far as disciplining is concerned. So, in order to get rid of all these moral, whether it's injustice in discipline, or sometimes wrongly accusing a child, or any other indiscrepancy could come. So, what one needs to do is very clear disciplinary rules have to be set in the family right from the time the child is small. What are the basic disciplinary rules? Again, the rules are, number one, who rules the family? Who rules the home? who rules this home? It is the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That has to be very clear right from the beginning. Allah and His word are the rulers in the family. And after that, Allah has made the Qawwam the father. And then, of course, the mother. So these things have to be very, very clear in the family, my dear sisters. This will solve major issues, first of all. Because any problem happens, where are you going to go to for reference? What's your reference point? What's your deciding factor? The book of Allah. What does Allah say? Then, of course, then comes all the other discipline factors, like whether it is establishing salah, whether it is, you know, sitting for the timings for the meals, or whether it is what time the children are supposed to have their chocolates, or when can they have an ice cream, especially when the children are little, you know, you need to set all these rules. Or when is it that they're going to go out and play? Everything, you know, best is what? Make the timetable, put it up on the chart, write down there, and put it where the child can see and read. Now, a 3 or 4 year old cannot read your, you know, the timetable when you write. This is the meal time. This is the play time. This time you've got to go to bed. Okay. This is the Wi-Fi time or Wi-Fi zone or whatever. So what do you do? How will you explain to a 3 year old that, you know, for example, if a 3 year old wants chocolates at the wrong time, just before the meal, if the baby is crying for sweets. So what do? You don't say no to the child. You hug the child and you say, of course you can have it, but go to the chart. See what's the time you can have. You can have it after your meal. Fine. So even if the child doesn't understand more or less of the timetable, but if they understand, okay, meal is drawn here. There's a plate of food. And under that, there is the sweet dish or the chocolate. Right? Or if the time fixed is after salah. So immediately after salah, you say that you can surely have your chocolate, but the time is when? Let the child go and find out when the time is. If the child is used to this, other disciplinary things will also be easy, right? It's very important to teach the child to put everything on paper. Even if the 4 or 5 year old cannot write, but you take your paper, you put up the timetable, and you put the chart there. And especially for the younger children, rewards and punishment, the stars that you give, that is proven to be one of the best ways. Of course, you know, times are changing. The parenting challenges have gone to another level now with the internet and the children, even the lower grade children use the internet now because everything is online, subhanallah. So the discipline will be even more challenging, but nothing is impossible, my dear sisters. And for discipline, one more very important thing to keep in mind is that once the child knows that mommy loves me, daddy loves me so much, but where principles are concerned, no one in the world can change them except the book of Allah, except the commandment of Allah. If Allah allows that, then and only then they will allow me to do it. Otherwise, nobody else in the world can change the mind of mommy. If it is the play, if it's not the playtime now, how much ever the child cries for playing, you're not supposed to do it. You don't need to scream on top of your voice. You don't need to do anything. You don't need to raise your voice. All you need to do is just to be calm and say, I'm so sorry, my darling. I cannot do that now because your playtime is so and so. Let the child cry. Let the child throw tantrums. At the most, you can hug the child, kiss the child. That's it. But you do not need to give in to the child. But if you have a busy schedule, if you have a call coming, then what will you do? Obviously, say, okay, go play now. The child, oh my God, she was getting so hyper, so I had to send her to play. Next time, the child will do it even more because she realized that throwing tantrums works. And when mommy is busy, she gives in. That is what you have taught the child, right? So it's very important that we as parents sit down and set the ground rules. Ground rules have to be very clear. This is the breakfast time. This is the dinner time. This is the sleeping time. And whatever you want the children to do, put it on paper. And they love it. They love securities. They love boundaries. Children, as far as that they are small, when they are young, they will love all this. Of course, when they grow, the challenges will grow. So you'll have to learn your tactics. You'll have to learn your skills. And my dear sisters, we are living in the age of media. I tell you what is the best way to get the best of techniques. All mothers can get this. Tell me, are you on social media? Do you use Google? Do you have internet in the house? Obviously, most of the parents, most of the mothers have. So what to do? If the child is throwing tantrums, all you have to do is Google there and write 6-year-old throwing tantrums. You'll get a list of all the solutions. Subhanallah, we are in the age of media. You don't even need to go to the specialist. Only if exceptional cases, maybe you need to go and consult specialist. But where tantrums are concerned, where behavior discipline is concerned, where so many standard things have been already put up, and 10 videos will come there. Sibling rivalry, put it there. You'll get all the videos on sibling rivalry. Islamic solution to sibling rivalry, put it, all that will come. What do you want? You need to do your research, my dear sisters. If you have an 8-year-old child who is having this problem, put the problem there. Inshallah, solution will come. Of course, you'll have to use your senses. Which is the best, which is better of the two, which falls into the Islamic category. Inshallah, that you can follow. If not 100%, at least to some extent, one can do that. We are empowered mothers today, mashallah. We have so much at our fingertips. Subhanallah. Even Islamic knowledge, you want to learn about something, just Google that. Just make sure it's the right thing, following the authentic Quran and Hadith, right? So we are in the age of technology and science and media, inshallah. And the last thing, but the most important, last but not the least, is making sincere dua. Stand up in the middle of the night, my dear. Bow down in sujood and cry out your heart to Allah. Instead of sitting and complaining and talking and discussing over the phone or talking about the child, always to somebody else, we need to talk to Allah about our children. Allah, you have granted me this treasure. You have granted me this honor. Not everyone is given the honor of raising children. You have granted me this honor. Make me capable, O my Lord. Grant me the wisdom of Luqman. Grant me the wisdom. Grant me the character and the akhlaq of a beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How he dealt with people. Allah, grant me all that. Imagine if you're going to cry to Allah, let the emotions flow. Let the tears flow. Ask Allah to equip. Allah will, if Allah grants the wisdom, then inshallah, then we can be the best of mothers. Now that you have cried to Allah in sujood, get up equipped, full of tawakkul, strong in believing with Allah. Strongly, now I have put all my problems to you, O my Lord. I have spoken to you everything, O my Lord, and I trust you, O Allah, that you can solve all these problems. You can make my children the best of children. You can grant them that wisdom, O my Lord. Make them the best for this world and akhirah. Let them be the leaders of and the role models and think tanks who can benefit the ummah. Let them be the coolness of my eyes, O my Lord. And once we ask all that, we cry to Allah and we stand up with confidence then. Because now we have been holding on to the most worthy hand. We have relied on the strongest of support that we can ever have. And that is Allah. We have tawakkal Allah. We trust Allah. And then we go out in the world and face the world, inshallah. Now we can be confident because we ask Allah. And Allah is going to protect us, inshallah. So hope that answers. And Allah knows best, inshallah. Any other questions, Sister Ruhaini?
There are a few. I'll just pick a few. Sister is saying that she is raising 4 children. Islamically is a challenge and she doesn't have much time for herself.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's again, you know, I know it can be very, very challenging. What we do is we ask Allah for barakah. We keep asking Allah for barakah. Barakah is, you know, what you can do in 4 hours. People take 40 hours to do. So ask Allah for barakah. Ask Allah for guidance. That is one thing. And of course, you know, trying to do as smartly as possible. Usually when the eldest child does most of the things, the others follow. Or usually when you teach one of them, the others follow suit. You know, that usually happens. But see, my dear sister, each child is different. Each child is different in terms of their passion, in terms of their, you know, in terms of their abilities, in terms of their talents. So it's not possible all the time to treat all of them in the same way. Some have some very striking qualities. Some are good at something else. Now it's very important to make sure that we bring out the best in each one of them. And as far as, you know, making the most time for yourself is concerned, you need to ask Allah for barakah. You need to do smart timetable for yourself so that you have some time for yourself. Because of course, if you're not going to recharge yourself, how are you? You're going to burn out then. So it's very important for you to recharge yourself. And this recharging depends. Sometimes bowing down in sujood is recharging, you know, and believe me, sisters, you go for salah in such a way that Allah, you have to recharge me. Allah, I stand before you and ask for hidayah. You are to guide me how I'm going to plan my day. You are going to tell me what I do and what I don't do. Keep asking through istikhara. Ask Allah to guide you. Inshallah, inshallah. The 5 times that we pray salah is for ourselves. That's the time we recharge ourselves, right? So sometime you have to take out either through sleeping a little bit less or some other way. You know, having your children besides you also, you can give time for yourself. So it all depends, you know, how smartly you organize things, inshallah. But be positive and we all pray that, you know, parenting is not a joke. Parenting is very challenging. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah makes it easy for all of us and makes it enjoyable for all of us and makes it the cooling of the eyes for all of us. One of the sisters, you know, is struggling in separation and she has specially asked all of us to pray for her. We pray for this particular sister who asked that she joins with her family. May Allah make it so. Because the angels are surrounding us right now, we say Ameen. Ameen, my dear sisters, all of you all say Ameen to this. May Allah unite all the broken homes. May Allah unite all the broken families, all the separated families. May Allah unite them in khair. And may they be more obedient to you, O Allah. We ask you, Allah, to ease parenting for us. We ask you, O Allah, to grant love and mercy in the hearts of spouses so that we can raise strong individuals, stronger families, and stronger homes because homes are the cornerstones of society. If we have stronger individuals, we'll have stronger families, and we'll have even stronger homes to build the ummah, inshallah. Inshallah. Ameen. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. It's already Maghrib Adhan here. So, over to Sister Ruhaini. We end the session, inshallah, hoping to have you and see you the next Sunday so that we can have part 7 and we can have the remaining 5 fundamentals of parenting with purpose, inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan kaseeran.
Jazakallahu khair, Mustada, for this wonderful session. I pray that Allah makes all our children the coolness of our eyes. We end our session today. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.